For today, we are going to do one more version of the same exercise that we have done last class on ESPs. But this time, I told you, remember, like when we were discussing about choke, okay? That way I told you, there are two ways that you can make calculations. One of them is to take out the element of interest from the picture, and then you see which combination of Q and delta P do you need. And then afterwards, you find an equipment that fulfills those requirements. I'm not sure if you remember that discussion. It was a long time ago in a far, far away galaxy. But the point was that, for example, if we are talking about a wellhead choke, here we have, for example, this wellhead choke, and maybe we're going to make it like this. Okay, I have two ways. One of them is just take it out of the picture, okay, and use that point as the element of interest, as the point of interest where I'm going to make my flow equilibrium, and then I calculate all the pressure available co-current from that point from the reservoir. And then the pressure, the required, calculated countercurrent, and then I say, okay, exactly to have that particular rate that I want, I need certain delta P. And I told you that the other option was just to leave the model of the equipment in the system. And you know, I didn't want to go to do it with the choke, but in this case, we're going to make it with the pump. Okay, so we are going to do the two approaches. And you will see they are very similar, but the including the model has some disadvantages that we will discuss during the exercise. Okay, and then we are going to talk about more general about multiphase boosting or subsea boosting. That is a way to, you know, to or increase production or prolong production, plateau production. And then we will have, if time allows, just a short class example with a compressor. Okay, so that's our kind of our working plan for today. Okay, so if you want to, you know, try to follow with me, here is the file that we are going to be working with. And let me open it. So it's exactly the same case that we saw last class, this Peregrino field. Okay. We have exactly everything is the same, but now what we are going to do is we are going to include the choke in the equation. Okay, we are not going to leave that empty the choke, the pump in the equation. We are not going to leave that empty space and see what do you want to get. Okay, so if you see, we have okay, reservoir pressure, water cut, average density that we calculate with the water cut. Viscosity that we calculate assuming that it has some certain emulsion behavior, and then we have the rate that the reservoir people want that we have to verify, and after that we can calculate with IPR, we are assuming we are producing an undersaturated bottom hole pressure, so we calculated bottom hole pressure, then rate of oil, water, and then P of the suction that will be the flow in the casing. Okay, I don't think I have a picture here, but if you remember what was our case, okay, we had the pump, and actually the pump was a bit higher than the perforations. Here you have a packer. And here I could say that I have just a constant wellhead pressure because I told you all wells are producing to the same header. And that header somehow, we don't care too much how they do it, is kept at a constant wellhead pressure of 7 bar. Okay. So we have flow in the casing, then we have flow inside the pump, and then we have flow in the tubing. Those are the three things. So now, so far I have done from the reservoir to the through the formation through the flowing bottom hole, and then I'm going from the bottom hole all the way to the suction of the pump. Okay, so that's what I have done so far. P suction, and the P suction is above the bubble point pressure or the pressure required at the intake, so I'm happy. So now I have to go, and I will propose that we are going to make everything co-current. Okay, I propose, because we have that the pressure here has to match exactly 7 bar. So I propose continue co-current almost all the way to the wellhead. Okay, and then we have to make, then you have in mind, okay, how we have been working all of this time is that we will have to change something such that the pressure, wellhead pressure calculated, is equal to the wellhead pressure that we provide, okay, 7 bar. And that something will be the frequency of the pump, okay? So let's, now we are at the pump suction, and let's continue. We want to calculate the pressure at the discharge of the pump, and for that there is a, there is an BVA function. Let's see how I called it. ESP calculation, P discharge of the pump, considering viscosity. Okay, remember one of them was without any correction, and this one was correcting it with the method from the Hydraulic Institute. So that's the one we are going to use, and I hope we are using exactly the same units that it requires. So that's going to be pump, no pressure, was it pressure, right? P discharge pump, okay? Viscous, and then we want one by one the P inlet, and that will change depending on each year. The rate, that rate is the total rate that the pump is, pumping, which is the total liquid rate. The frequency, we don't know really what will be the frequency. That's the parameter that we want to adjust. But here I assume 53. If we remember from last class, I think the value was 52.2. So I'm assuming 53. Number, that N is number of stages that the pump has. So we have 78, and that should be blocked. The density, again, might change. Then viscosity, reference frequency, that is to which frequency the coefficients correspond. If you remember, we were tuning the pump performance with some coefficients, A, 5, 4, 3, 2, and 1, and we want to be sure that at which frequency does that line specify, because then we have to scale the curve for other frequencies. So that was this 60 here. Okay, and I'm going to block that cell. Viscosity, that's going to be that cell here. And the best efficiency point, that's something we need for the correction. So that was this 1987. And then we need all the coefficients of the pump for water performance and for that particular frequency. So we are going to use that one. Then maybe I can copy that and then just use, one will be C2, D2, E2, and F2. Okay. Yes, I think I'm, so let me check, the last one should be 31, so let's check that here, 31, yeah, that's correct, the last coefficient of the pump curve, and I got 188 pressure at the discharge. So that means it increased almost like 110 bar. Okay, the delta P. Then I can calculate these things, but I don't really need them because I'm not going to use the plot, okay, of the pump performance. I'm just going to use the model, but I just to calculate it anyhow. So that will be the pressure at the discharge minus the pressure at the suction, 113. The head, it's just that number divided by the density, but times the, is that all?
Times G.
Times the yeah, gravitational acceleration, which is 9.81. Oh, but I have to make it in units, consistent units, okay? So I have to multiply times 1 e to the 5, so it will be in Pascal, yeah? And then I have to go, I have to continue. Now I have just, in my drawing, I have been from the reservoir to the bottom hole, then bottom hole to the suction with pipe flow, and then from the suction to the discharge with the pump equation, okay? So now I have to go all the way to the wellhead. And for that, I need, again, flow through tubing. And that, I think that equation that we used last time was single phase. And that was P out, okay? Remember, we have P in, we have fixed P out. We can calculate what is the pressure upstream, or we have the pressure upstream, and we want to calculate what is the pressure downstream. Okay, keep that in mind always. You know, especially for the exam. So that will be P out, and let's see what things we need. We need the total rate, that one. We need the internal diameter of the conduit, that is the diameter of the tubing, D2. Then the density of the fluid, this one. Viscosity of the fluid, this one. The length of that section, and the length is H2. Oh, that one, I should block it, right? Then the angle, that's given, I think, in degrees, so the angle will be 90. Okay, I think so. We will check now the units, but I think that's the angle from the horizontal. Then P in will be the P at the discharge of the pump. The roughness of the pipe, okay, and in that case I got lucky, maybe I was doing it from before, but you see that the pressure almost matches 7, okay? What happens if it didn't match? If we assume, for example, initially 30 hertz, okay? You see that actually the wellhead pressure is negative, because with that frequency I cannot lift that rate, okay? So I could do it manually. I could start increasing 40, 50, okay, 60, and now I have 57, and I want it to be exactly 7. So for that, we know we have a good friend that is called the solver. We have to make these automatic things that humans are not very good, many repetitive things. So we use the solver. And we say, actually it's already filled here for you, maybe not. Yeah. So that pressure, I want it to be exactly 7 by changing the frequency. Okay. And it found exactly 53. Yeah, and I think from last class, just from the graphical estimation was, let me just open it. Okay, we got from graphical inspection 52.5, so it's relatively close. Okay, and the rest, you know, I just left it already there to calculate the efficiency, the power, and the Q min and Q max. So what you have to verify is that the power is less than the maximum. You have to verify that the Q total, will be between Qmin and Qmax, which is, and you have to verify that the pressure at the suction of the pump is above that pressure. Okay, so everything in this particular point in time looks okay. Yeah? But you see the difference between the two approaches. Okay, one of them, you need to have an equation, and you need to, you have in that equation, you have something that you can change. You have a variable that you can modify. So you have to modify that variable until you get exactly the rate that you want, or the delta P that you want. That's completely different from the first approach, okay? In the first approach, we just say, we assume that I can produce that. So I assume that rate, I assume that delta P, and then after I verify visually, graphically, whatever, that I'm inside the operational map, okay? And, you know, there are, usually in commercial software, we use the approach that we are doing today, okay? Including the model in the, because you have, sometimes it's difficult just to make the graphical, because you have a system that you have, for example, networks, you have many wells, the viscosity is changing, so many things are changing, so in that case it's better to use the model, okay? Because you cannot represent everything on one single map. Okay, should we make the next years, or you want to do it as a homework? Okay, we do it the other years? Okay. So let's drag that first, okay? That will remain the same because the water cut doesn't change. And I think this one we can just drag down, right? Because everything, if I have done everything correctly with no mistakes, I should be able to drag that down. Okay, and the frequency it increased. Okay, but that one should remain always 7. Okay, so we are getting a negative wellhead pressure, which is non-physical for the second year, for the second reservoir pressure. So that means that we have probably to increase the frequency, right? Because we want the pump to give more energy to the fluid, okay? So let's do that, and for that I say I want that number to be exactly equal to 7 by changing that frequency. Okay, and it gave exactly 55, and I think from last class we found was 55, okay? So spot on. Okay, then so far you have to verify visually, you know, what we could have kind of a condition to give us a flag if one of the constraints is violated. But let's make it just for time being, let's make it visually. So the rate is 1700, and that's between those two numbers, that looks fine. The pump power is below the maximum power given, that's also fine. The suction pressure is 59, which is above 36. So that looks fine, okay? So let's go to the third, and for the third I'm just going to change here 18, 19, and solve. Okay. And it gave a frequency of 57.4, and all the rest, it's fine, right? Yeah, so the third year, again, no problem, and that's exactly what we obtained last class. That the third point is still okay, is fine. And the frequency was 57.5. Okay, so how much did we get? 57.4. Okay, so we know how to read the pump curve. So let's try the fourth year, that will be 20, and that will be 20, okay, and I try to solve, and you see this frequency now, in that case it gave a bit higher. If we are limiting from 30 between 30 to 60, then that means that we are a bit high, hey, we are 1 hertz high, but we maybe can sacrifice not to produce exactly the rate, but be producing at maximum frequency. So that's not much of a problem. But let's see all the other things. Like, we have the rate, again, falls between the range, that's fine. The power. The power is higher, okay, which we don't like, okay? And then the other thing that is important is the pressure at the suction is lower than 36, okay? So any suggestion how to fix that problem? Solver or I need to decrease the rate, right? Because the pressure here is too low, but that pressure depends only on the rate. That doesn't depend on the frequency, okay? That depends only on the rate that I'm imposing, okay, that I'm fixing. That depends only on the 1700. So I have to decrease it until I get exactly here, 36. So I suggest first, as a first approach, to use the solver to say, please change that rate until that pressure is exactly 36, okay? Because that's going to be the minimum rate that I have to produce. So let's use the solver in that condition. I say, I want that pressure to be exactly that number, 36. By changing that rate, okay, and I found that it has to be reduced 1470, okay, and then with that number I can say again, please change the frequency until I get exactly 7 at the wellhead, right? That's one approach that I'm showing you, is step by step. So that number has to be equal to 7 by changing the frequency. Okay, and I got, if you see now, let's verify, the frequency is within 30 and 60, which is fine. The pressure is exactly 36. These two are the same, the wellhead pressure calculated and required. And the rate is between those two. Okay, and the power is also below 950. So everything looks fine. And that's exactly what we found last class, that the rate had to be reduced to 1470. Okay. And it was in our case 56, and how much we are getting? 56.5. Okay. Should we try the next year? The next year I think was still fine. The next year, well, was a bit outside. Okay, so let's try. So in this one, we are going to make the same trick. We have to reduce that rate to get exactly a pressure here of 36. So let's try that. That number has to be equal to 36 by changing, it should be, yeah, J21. Okay, then I have to reduce the rate further to 1100. Okay, and then I do the same to make that pressure equal to that pressure. Just so, one question I have just to wake you up a bit. Can I operate in these conditions? I mean, is this, if I put the pump to operate at 57 hertz, can I operate? Is that a feasible operational point? If you see, usually every well has something that we are not considering here, okay? But every well has a choke, okay? A wellhead choke. So if I here have 7, I really can have any pressure here greater than 7, but I could choke, you know, just choke the well until I get exactly, you know, to bridge the difference, okay? But in this case, we are assuming that the choke is fully open. And why is that? Because it really doesn't make sense. Remember, what the choke does is remove energy from the fluid. It's dropping pressure, causing a very kind of a sink of energy. And what is the pump doing? The pump is giving energy to the fluid. So really it doesn't make sense to give energy and then remove it. Okay, it's a bit inefficient process, right? Okay, but in theory, if you want to produce here, you could produce at that particular frequency and just put a choke between that and that. That reaches 19 bar, the choke, okay? And many systems, don't be surprised when you see it in you go to the field, many systems are operating like that. Just to know, to get exactly the operational point, they use a choke. Okay, so now let's use, to make it proper, we want to make that value equal to 7. And then by changing that frequency, right? So the frequency looks okay. It looks between 30 and 60. Pressure of the suction looks also fine. These two pressures are the same. The power looks also okay. But what doesn't look okay? The rate, okay? The rate is not between, in between that range. Okay, it's below that. But it's, you know, just in the limit, so maybe we can live with it because all the rest looks fine. Yep. And then we do very quickly the last one. And again, we say that pressure. So, is there any other way of, you know, of doing, without doing two steps, can I put everything in the same solver? Because now we are doing one solver first for the rate and then another solver for the frequency. But can we put the two things in the same solver? Yeah, we can try, okay? So in that case, I will have to change two variables, the rate and the frequency. So let's try to make it. I want to change that number, okay? Sorry. I want to change that number and that number, right? Such that what?
Suction pressure is equal to 7.
Okay, let's we can do something. We can say we want that pressure, right, to be exactly equal to 7. Hmm? That's our first goal, right? That the pressure will be exactly equal to 7 bar. Then the other goal is that I'm going to add the other things like a constraint. So the other is that pressure should be greater or equal than 36, right? Then the other constraint is that the power should be less or equal than 950. And then the other constraint is that the rate has to be less or equal than that, okay, and has to be, or the rate has to be greater or equal than that. Hmm? Yeah. And the frequency has to be between, that number has to be between less or equal than 60, and the frequency has to be greater or equal than 30. But one question I have for you, is that going to give us the maximum rate that you can get from the system? Okay, or not? Because we know we want to produce as much as possible. Okay, so I'm asking you if this approach really is maximizing rate.
No.
It's not, right?
Yeah.
So you can find any rate that is below the maximum that you can get, that maybe complies with that condition. So what I propose is change that condition and say I want to maximize the rate, okay? The same variable that I'm changing, but now subjected to all of the other constraints. Okay, and one of the constraints is that number will be equal to that number. Okay. And then I'm going to put another constraint just in case that that number has to be less or equal than 1700. Okay? Because if I could produce more, just in case, I don't want to produce more. Okay, so let's go through it. I want to maximize rate by changing rate, which sounds a bit strange, but yeah, here I have a problem. In here it should be 22, right? And 22. I want the rate, if you can go above 1700, I don't go, okay? I want the rate to be greater than the max, the minimum. I want the rate to be, no, that's not the rate, that's what? J22. The P suction to be greater or equal than that number here. I want the frequency to be between 60 and 30. I want the wellhead pressure to be equal to 7. The wellhead pressure is so 22 equal to P22. I want the power to be less than that number. Okay. And then the last one, I want the T22. And that I think is written wrongly, right? That should be that the rate should be less or equal than T22, right? So it's good all the time to do some quality control. So what do you think is going to give us, able to give us a solution? Do you think? Is solver so powerful? We already saw, right, from last class that there was no way to move it inside the area. So let's try. Okay. And of course didn't find a solution. Okay. Said 60, but here I'm violating P of suction. The rate is high, but I'm within the range, okay? But the pressure of the suction, I'm below 36. Okay? So why I took all of that time to do that exercise, okay? If you have a feasible point, it will find it, okay? Very quickly. It will be very efficient at finding the feasible point if you use that formulation. You can even try it for the previous points that we know that we will have a solution. But for points where it's not feasible, this methodology will fail. And that's what you have to be careful when you go and use a commercial simulator, when you go and use a prepared tool that has built-in model, because they have some kind of a solver to find to do exactly this process that we have been doing. Okay? And sometimes it crashes, sometimes it fails, and you have to be aware of that issue. It's because of that. Because sometimes, no matter what you do, you cannot put the point back in the operational envelope. Okay? So if, for example, the software gives you, I don't converge, I didn't find the point, you might think that the equipment that you are using is not suitable for the operation that you want. Okay? But I recommend, so in that case, you know, we don't have a feasible point. We can do it the same way we have done before. That we say, I want to make that pressure exactly equal to 36 by changing the rate. Okay, and then I can do exactly the same that I want the wellhead pressure to be exactly 7 by changing the frequency. But then I still have the violation on the minimum rate. Okay, I'm outside the envelope. Okay? That here, that example, yeah? You're going to get it on the exercise. Okay? But there are two ways, just taking the points, plotting them on the envelope, or including the model. And be aware that when you include the model, you have to be a bit careful. Okay, so So let's maybe copy that. Okay, and sometimes I just, especially for pump, for example, it's relatively, you know, good the model that we have. These equations represent relatively okay the reality, the measurement. But for some other models, like for example chokes, or for multiphase boosters, or when you have some other kind of more evil emulsions, it doesn't behave so well, okay, the models. So you have to be, sometimes these models are very, very complex. And just to make the point, maybe they make your life a bit difficult, okay? So just take that into account for some particular components. So now let's close our discussion on ESPs. It took quite some time, but I think it was necessary. So let's go back to our case of this field, Snow White. Okay, Snow White, or our case, also the field is block B2 in Tanzania. I don't think we had, maybe we had this discussion informally, but what are ways, what can we do to prolong the plateau? Okay. And remember we had, like, we have two things. We have an intersection, okay, of required and available. So we can make something to increase the available pressure, or we can do something to decrease the required pressure, right? So these are basically the two things. Increase available pressure. Okay, and the point that we are using is the wellhead pressure. Okay, PWH, and decrease required pressure. Remember that we had a plot, something like this, and that's where here we are producing that rate, that's the plateau rate. Okay, and if we want to produce for a longer time, then we have to make that curve something like this, right? Or the other curve, we have to make it something like that, such that the natural equilibrium point will be much further to the right, and then we have, with depletion, we will have more time before the end of the plateau reaches. Okay? So these methods, let me write them down. So methods that are methods to increase available pressure. Okay, any ideas? We can go from the most upstream component and, you know, just downstream. So the most upstream component is the reservoir, right? So what can we do in the reservoir to increase available pressure? Or at least to maintain available pressure? We can do things to increase the productivity of the formation, right? To increase, if we see our equation, okay, our equation was Q of the gas, C back pressure exponent, coefficient, PR, yeah? Okay, so we can try to increase that, so we are going to get more rate with the same bottom hole pressure. But how do we increase that coefficient? That you have seen before. So that's what we call increase reservoir deliverability. And we can make by acidizing, for example. Okay, we remove the damage caused by the drilling. Acidizing And that's basically injecting chemicals to improve permeability region. Okay, what else can I do? I can also do fracturing. Okay, I can create, if I see my wellbore from the top, I can create, it's kind of a frack. And then that will increase the exposure, increase wellbore formation exposure. Okay, what else can I make to increase the deliverability? I can also have more branches, okay? Or I could also have more laterals. I can have more kind of wells inside the same well. Or I could also perforate in some other intervals. Okay, so I can have multilaterals. Multi-layer, so I can perforate in another segment. Yeah. Or now we don't talk too much about this Snow White or Block 2, but we can also make some, remember what we talked about, that we can put some device inside the wellbore that will restrict, if we have too much gas production or too much water production, that is kind of taking over our main oil, for example, production or water production, we can use this inflow control devices. Okay, remember that gas or water, they take space, for example, in case of the oil, they take space from the oil. Okay, you start to produce that. So if the inflow sometimes tries to even to balance the pressure in the wellbore, so you have an even depletion, okay, or it tries to hinder the flow of this of gas and water. Okay, should we take a break? 15 minutes? Okay, so then we continue. That's more or less what we can do, and also we can, that's really not improving the productivity of the reservoir, but that's basically just maintaining or controlling a bit the decline of the pressure. So for that you can use also a pressure support. And depending on the case, we might have water injection or gas injection. Okay, that's basically to control the decline of. Okay. And remember, all of these things that we are mentioning, they cost money. So we always have to. Always there is some kind of economical analysis to evaluate if really it's worth the investment, if really how much can I get out of it. Then we go and move downstream to the tubing, okay, in well, in the tubing, and in the tubing I can make different things. One of them is the most obvious, is to increase tubing size, tubing internal diameter. Another option is to put install artificial lift. Okay, that gives energy to the fluid. And in that case, we have all of these pumps. We have ESP, electric submersible pumps. We have progressive cavity pumps, not used so much offshore. We have also jet pump that we didn't discuss. We have also gas lift. Okay, but please know that we don't have for gas wells, we don't have any rotating equipment inside the well. We don't have like an in-well compressor. Okay. Then some other ways are to reduce the viscosity of the fluid, and that I use by demulsifiers. Okay, that's basically, if you remember that plot from 1, 0 to 1 and the viscosity of the mixture. Okay, basically that tries to bring it so the peak will be lower and that it exhibits lower mixture viscosities. That will be the emulsifier. So another way will be to inject diluent that is a lighter API oil. Okay, basically that one has a relatively low viscosity. When I mix it with some oil that has high viscosity, that reduces the overall viscosity of the fluid. Then I have one more thing that I can make, is to increase the number of wells. Okay, and that, I think you have, it's like if you can imagine it, if you have some point reservoir pressure and some point where you have the separator pressure and you just have one conduit, okay? That will have probably a very high pressure drop depending on the rate that you're using. So if I just connect those two points with many conduits, okay, the delta P in each conduit is less, okay? And if the delta P is less, that means that the intersection again is more to the right. So that's also one approach, but that's also extremely expensive. Okay, and I think that's all. And here I have, it's extremely important to make that calculation that you have made, that the number of wells, how the NPV changes, and exactly to find the point where it is maximum. Okay, then we move to the required. So far we have reached already the wellhead. Okay, so now we move to the reducing required pressure. And that is also changing the size, and basically is the internal diameter of a transportation flow lines and pipelines. But remember, higher diameter, then higher the cost, okay? And also, it's not always, especially in these cases that I mentioned, that you have, for example, gas flow with some liquid, okay? When you increase too much the diameter of the pipe, you start getting accumulation, okay? The flow of gas is not enough to drag the droplets with it, so the droplets starts to accumulate, and then you have all of these cyclic phenomena. That you start slugging, cyclic production, and you have a lot of issues because of that, because of liquid accumulation. So I'm going to put here a warning. Okay, the velocity should also be high enough. In that case, you can, I mean, a bit sacrifice, but you want to avoid all of these transients in the pipe, all of this liquid accumulation. Okay, and so more things that can be done. So what else can be done? We can again also inject some if they reduce the viscosity of the mixture if we have an emulsion, and for that we might inject again demulsifier or diluent, but this is usually done in each well, so it's not so common. What else can we do on that curve? We can also reduce separator pressure. But I'm going to make something here so you remember. Okay, that's a big change. And that actually some fields, some gas fields, they are planning to do that in the life of the field. Like you will say, Snøhvit has planned to do it, but this is a big change in topside or processing facilities. So it's not so easy. Of course, it reduces because the pressure, the back pressure that you have, the separator pressure, is going to be lower, so all the curve is going to be shifted down. But it's a big change that is not something that we do lightly, and it's something that needs careful planning and evaluation. But it, of course, can give us a lot of production. Then we have other things, subsea processing. For example, a separation of oil and water, oil, gas, and water. And that's basically to avoid unnecessary losses, energy losses. When you carry water, it's very heavy. The density is very high. So when you carry water all the way from the seabed to the topside, maybe that has a high, that causes a very high pressure drop. So if I manage to separate subsea the water and then just dispose from it or inject it, that I save that extra pressure drop, I save it, and that reflects in production to avoid unnecessary transportation losses. Okay, but keep in mind also, if I take gas, I also am increasing the density of the mixture. Okay, for example, if I start producing only oil, the viscosity and the density will be much higher. And in that case, I might have even more pressure drop than in the case with gas. The gas actually is helping the production. So keep in mind, separation not always gives you more production. But in the case of water, it's extremely important to avoid unnecessary transportation losses from seabed to topside. Okay, especially if the depth of the subsea is significant. Okay, and then we come to the topic that was for discussion today, that was subsea boosting. And subsea boosting basically consists on installing, if you have a group of wells, for example, and usually I try to make it in a group of wells, okay, because it's relatively expensive to make it only for one well. And then I put a box here. That will be my booster. And here I have, let me make it more schematic. Okay, and here I have my multi-phase booster, or my booster. Let's call it just generally subsea booster. And that basically bridges exactly the same thing, but now it's made on a system level, that I have some pressure available at the suction, some pressure required, and I want to use that to bridge. And we are going to make an exercise, I hope soon, about Snow White. But exactly the same thing. And I can have I can have two types of booster, and one of them is single phase, either liquid or gas, or I could have multiphase. That means that they process all liquids, everything, all the stream that comes from the wells. Okay, that means that processes oil, gas, and water. And if you feel that option is relatively, I don't have to make intervention on the well, so it's less expensive. I don't have to be maintaining. If something happens, I have just one location where I can make go and retrieve or fix. So it's expensive, but it's really more less expensive than doing it in some other places in the system usually. Okay. And for single phase, usually that one requires, like you will suspect, that requires separation before. Okay. And that usually can take just the stream the way it is. And we have two types of boosting principles. And one of them is called the positive displacement. And we have this rotor dynamic. I think we have discussed this before. Okay. Positive displacement usually gives higher delta P. Yeah, and that one gives medium to low delta P. And the problem with this type of pump is that they don't tolerate solids, while these ones, they have some tolerance to solids. But they are usually made for lower rates, and these are for medium and high rates. Okay, so I'm going to talk now about, in particular, about multiphase boosters. Okay, and give some, like, the two poster childs of each of these two technologies. So one of them is a twin screw pump. So that one example of this technology is twin screw pump. Okay, where you have two screws. I think I had a better picture. Okay, where you have two screws that where the fluid is carried from the outer side to the inner side. Okay, and it's carried by the formation of cavities through the two screws, and the fluid is basically going and circulating through that cavities from the right to the left. Okay, just like you see it in this. So let's take that was the image I was missing. And if we say the liquid, basically, or the fluid, is basically enters through here, and then it travels with the formation of cavities from there all the way to the discharge, okay? Just like it's shown in the figure. And the other technology that you use for rotor dynamic, like multiphase flow, is called helicoaxial pump, HAP. Helicoaxial pump. Okay. Remember what I told you, that when you have, like in the case of ESPs, when you have something that is very radial, that has a change in direction, you remember that discussion we had? That I think was in when we were just starting to talk about ESPs. Okay, I told you that that change of direction, very abrupt, that's what we call kind of a radial impeller. And that change of direction is very bad for the efficiency, because you can have the separation of the gas, and after you have the separation, it starts to occupy a significant place in the channel, and then that kind of hinders the passage of, or makes more difficult the passage of the main stream. Hmm? So we don't want usually those type of impellers that are radial, we don't want to use them for multiphase flow. So what we use is something more like this type that we call a semi-axial, or we use this helicoaxial that I'm going to show you a figure just now. Okay, that's how it looks like. So the fluid goes exactly in the axial direction, and you have a sequence of, okay, so the fluid goes, and if you see, it's very much like almost like a torch, okay, it's very much, it's like, it's different than that case that they are more or less oriented to the, through the axial direction, but in this case, they're very much torched, they're almost like some kind of spiral shape. And that's to avoid separation, enhance mixing, and avoid the separation in these interblade passages. Okay, and that was in the past made by Framo, and now I think they are called OneSubsea, right? Part of the Schlumberger group. Okay, and they are the ones that are responsible to manufacture most of these devices, and really they are most of the market in subsea multiphase boosting. It's helicoaxial. Okay. So if you want, I just want to. So we are not going to dwell, because I'm just going to show you that it exists. Okay, something that can handle the whole flow of the was without any separation. And that you are aware of the main types that they that exist, and but really we, because we don't have, actually for these boosters there is not really a universal model that fits every, that fits everything. Okay, like for ESPs, you need to, it depends on the particular case, usually, and we use values measured on the test experimentally that we test. So many of these boosters, you see some news clips that they say we have done, we are doing a testing campaign of this booster someplace, or so that's because there is no universal equation that can predict first and that can tell you how it's going to behave. So you need to do a lot of testing. So for that, we cannot make kind of an exercise, or I cannot give you theory about it, and it's also not the point of the course, but just to make you aware that they exist, and also there is a, I'm going to, it's also in the same website, in the same folder, class files and the date of today. You have there the poster that is free on the web by Intexi, and that shows in a very nice manner where do you have all the boosters and what type they are, if they operate with multiphase or single phase, and where they are located, the capacity, etc. Okay. Subsea boosting gives you everything that is installed nowadays, which type of booster it is, what kind of power it has, where is it located, what delta P does it breach, etc. So I recommend, if you have time, you are free, you know, you don't have anything to do on a Friday night or something, so you go and check more or less what's in the market. Okay, but you have it there if you want to check it. But now I want to steer a bit your attention to, again, we have, that's something else I want to show. It's, okay, we have also a different type from these two, apart from these two. There is a special type of booster to deal with gas with some amount of liquid. That we call wet gas compressor. Okay, lots of gas with some liquid. And in that case, again, we continue with the axial distribution because it you know, it hinders a bit separation. But also this one has a very, so that's a wet gas compressor, again, of Framo, and has a very special design where you have two impellers. You actually have no diffuser. Okay, remember the diffuser in that case, in the helicoaxial pump, that one is rotating, and that one is static, it's not moving, and it's just to recover pressure. Remember that in a rotor dynamic pump, we have transfer of energy, recovery of pressure, transfer of energy, recovery of pressure. But in that case, we have, all of them are rotors. You have one, two, three, four. And one is rotating on this direction, and the next one is rotating on the opposite direction. Okay, so we call it is counter rotating a wet gas and okay. So, and the nice thing is that the gas liquid mixture behaves, or is possible to model it, has a mixture with average properties. Okay, just like what we do with this single phase flow, with this flow of oil and water. A gas liquid mixture is possible to model it. Okay, so just to make you aware of subsea boosters, where are they popular, which types they are, and really that's the most popular. These types, twin screw pumps, we had like four, I think, installed, but they have been reducing. We are not sure why, but they have been reducing the share of the market. And then you have something in between, which they have some mixed flow, but they are limited in the amount of GBF they can take, the amount of gas that they can take. And for the special case of gas with some liquid, you have this wet gas compressor that, of course, the, okay, remember the, okay, if we are going to put from 0 to 1, okay, that will be the GBF, gas volume fraction. I think, I'm not sure if we have introduced the term before, GBF. And that will be the Q of gas divided by Q of oil plus Q of water plus Q of gas, and all of these at local conditions. And it's usually a compressor or booster inlet. So we are saying from 0 to maybe 10% all the way. Some people are trying to stretch it to 20%. Here we use these centrifugal or radial impellers. Radial, centrifugal. Okay, from 0 to 10%, as that's where you have this ESP. Then if you go all the way maybe to 50%, let's make that 50 or 0.5. I think we are talking about fraction. Then we can have these mixed flow impellers. Okay, that they are, they not go, don't go exactly radial and they don't go exactly axial. They go in something in between. And then for the whole range, you can have this axial impeller. Okay, like for example the helicoaxial pump and also the wet gas compressor. They can in theory operate through the whole range. The problem is that usually this type of booster has high delta P, can give you a high delta P, and that one usually gives a lower delta P. So if you want exactly, so if you want a big delta P with this machine, you will have to put a lot of stages, okay? So that one requires, so let's put it here, that comment usually requires more stages than a centrifugal for the same delta P. So it depends really on which delta P exactly you require. But if it's axial, remember that you will have to put usually a lot of stages one after the other, and there is a limit physically on the amount of stages that we can put on a machine. Okay. Now, but we are going to have this exercise that we are going to make is going to be on single phase subsea boosters. Okay? And remember, here we need separation before. Okay? And the separation before is actually, you know, also something very complex that we, I'm just going to cover it schematically. So that's from, so we have, currently we have one installation, which is OSCAR, subsea compression is called. And there I have a dry compressor plus as a separation station. And you can see that exactly is from that you need to have a cooler, okay, to be able to condensate, to take liquid out of the gas. Then you have this scrubber. That's when you, it's like a vertical separator where you separate the liquid from the gas. And then the gas goes to a, just like a regular compressor. Okay, in that case, we can use just a centrifugal compressor. We don't want to be, we're not concerned about the GVF. So that's actually a centrifugal compressor. Then we don't want to carry two lines later to the platform, but we just mix it after the compressor. We mix again the liquid and the gas after the compressor. So we increase their pressure separately of the liquid and the gas. Okay? So exactly the same. Cooling to get more liquid out of the gas. Take the dry gas, introduce it to the compressor. Take the liquid, introduce it to a pump, and then combine them. And I think I have a picture of how the system looks like. Okay, so you see the size is huge. Okay, here you have a person, how it looks like. So you have the cooler to be able to reduce the temperature significantly, because you're using just the, you know, this, what I told you before, this free convection. So you need a big area, a heat to exchange heat with the environment, to be able to reduce the temperature significantly. So that's why that module is so big. Then you have the scrubber, and then you have the module of the pump, that is that one here, and you have the module of the compressor that is here. Okay. So we are going to study on the exercise we are going to make is going to be on Snow White, and we are going to use just like if it was a compressor. It will have some liquid, and it still isn't decided yet if they will go for that solution, separate the streams, boost them, and then mix them, or if they will use just a wet gas compressor. But we are going to make it assuming that we just are considering the gas, okay? And the gas, for that we will need to refresh some of our knowledge on compressor, and that's what I'm going to do now.
So what is the research?
It's
research.
Okay. Yep. I well, during, if you have liquid flowing through a pump, does it have an increase in temperature? Well, it has some increase, but it's not significant, okay? But when you have a gas through a compressor, then the temperature increases significantly, okay, during the compression process. And we will see there are some restrictions. That's, you know, what we are going to see on the exercise, that the temperature in here, you have connected the main transportation line, okay? And for example, the material tolerates a maximum temperature that you have to honor. Also, if you have here injection of this hydride inhibitor, this glycol also has some vaporization temperature that you cannot go above it, because otherwise it will stay in the gas and won't stay in the liquid, and then you have no protection against hydride. Okay, and also, not exactly in this exercise, but sometimes you want to reduce the temperature, because then you have problems in the seals. Okay, this is a rotating machine, so it has a part that is fixed and a part that is rotating, and you have to have a seal in between them. So that's why you cannot increase the temperature so much. So there are many reasons, but basically here the discharge cooler is just to avoid that you will have a very high temperature in the pipeline that will cause some structural damages, and also some for the hydride inhibitor to avoid vaporizing it. Okay. So let's before we take another break, let's present a bit this Snubbit case. So let's talk in particular and you see that's kind of the potential, okay? What they're plotting here is this potential. And when the potential is equal to the plateau, then you have the end of the plateau, okay? And what they say is that they first, when they're very close to reach the end of the plateau, they drill new wells, okay? They put also an onshore compressor. Then they put into operation a neighboring field, a neighboring template called Askeladd. And after that, they are going to install an offshore compressor, yeah, subsea compressor. And that's the case that we are going to analyze here in class, okay? Yeah, something that we forgot, that new pipeline. So here we can, you know, something that we forgot in this, changing the size, or we can put also another pipeline, a parallel pipeline. Okay, so we are going to analyze our case from here, assuming that we have been already up to the plateau and we have been already able to produce successfully our field at the rate that we want. And then we have to go from this point to make some subsea compression. Okay? And if you see, I have another figure here. Okay, exactly 20 million. That's what we used in the exercise in class. So first will be Snowit and Albatros, then Askeladd, and then you have a subsea compression. Okay, so that's exactly the period that we're going to model. And also, so here we're going to make it just one way, okay? The way that we are going to make visual inspection, that we have the combination of Q and delta P, we're going to put it in the map and see if we can deliver or not the combination. We are not going to make the modeling part because it might be a bit heavy on the compression side. So let's, before we dive into the into the Excel sheet, just make a small refreshment. I guess all of you are experts in compressor. I trust, no? Okay. Remember the equation that we mentioned before, okay, work or power equal to the first law of the thermodynamics for open systems, H2 minus H1, okay, still holds. So here we're going to say 1 and 2. Okay, that's a compressor. But now we cannot neglect really what we have done in the previous case was neglecting the internal energy, okay, in the pump case. We said really there is not much change in the temperature, so we just have the main increase is just by this density times delta P, right? That's what we have done in the pump. But now in this case, the temperature increase will be significant. So we cannot neglect that, and really we have to be able to compute exactly the delta in enthalpy. Okay, so if you remember, if I compress in an ideal manner, I compress ideally, what is the most ideal process that I can use to take a fluid from a condition 1 to 2, from a pressure 1 to a pressure 2? That I will use the least amount of work, the least amount of effort.
Adiabatic?
Isentropic, okay? The S1 equal to S2. The entropy should be the same, okay? So if that's the case, the temperature can be predicted as T2 over T1, T2 isentropic. I'm going to put an S here. That will be P2 over P1, K minus 1 over K. Okay, that equation brings some memories, old memories, good memories, I'm not sure. But this also we can say RP K minus 1 over K. Okay, and K is the ratio of specific heats, okay, CP over CV, and usually also K is a function of temperature. Okay, so that's how we calculate the ideal. If I don't use strictly only what required, I make it the most efficient possible, that is actually impossible, okay, but if I use the most efficient process, somehow magically I do it, that will be the increase in temperature that I will have, assuming an isentropic expansion, compression, okay? But in reality, the process is not isentropic. Okay? So the temperature will increase higher. It will be at a higher value than this T2S. It will be higher, okay? Because I have, it's like I invest part of the power to compress the fluid, and then I invest part of the power to heat the fluid. I lose part of this power in heating the fluid, which is not something that I want, that I intend. And actually, I represent the compression process is represented with a polytropic process. Okay, that means that PV to the power of n is just constant. And this n is what I call the polytropic exponent. And then I can say that T2 real over T1 is going to be equal to RP, but now the exponent won't be K, like in the isentropic case, but in that case will be N minus 1 over N. And I really don't want to go too much into the details, but the real, yeah, because that's you lost just like refreshment, but the real compression power required is given by, okay, and is the following expression. The power of compression required, real, is the mass flow times delta HP divided by efficient polytropic efficiency and the mechanical efficiency. Okay, so that's the what we call the polytropic not the head, but the polytropic enthalpy difference. The mass flow rate, just like in the previous case, and here you have some efficiencies that one you already know, have an idea, is close to 90%, 95%. And this polytropic efficiency comes given by the following formula. It's N minus 1 over N equal to K minus 1 over K times the polytropic efficiency. So if I have the polytropic exponent, if I know how it deviates from my isentropic trajectory, I can have right away the polytropic efficiency. Okay, and this term, this delta HP, it's equal to M over NP M Okay, so that's what I call the delta polytropic, the difference in polytropic, the difference in enthalpy calculated in a polytropic way. Okay, and this R is not the universal gas constant, so I'm going to put a bar, or maybe, yeah, let's pull a bar on top. So this R is a universal gas constant divided by the molecular weight of the gas. And this set average is a set 1 plus set 2 divided by 2. Okay, is the deviation factor calculated at the inlet and at the outlet. Okay, then we take a break and then we start seeing how we can use, you know, compression theory for our exercise to designing subsea compression in the Snøhvit field. Okay, so let's take 15 minutes break. Okay, we come back. So that's just to give you, you know, we have already done it with pumps. With pumps it's a bit simpler because it's a incompressible fluid. But with compressor, you have to take the temperature into account. So we cannot avoid these equations. We have to show it to you. I guess you have seen them in some previous course. But just like, you know, if we are, let's say, that 1 megapascal at a temperature of a well stream that, let's say, is like in our case of Snøhvit, that is 67, the temperature is here, 50, and the temperature actually goes 90, 80, 70, 60, and 50. So let's say we have 70, okay? And that we are at 10 bar at the suction of the compressor. Okay? And let's say we want to compress all the way to, let's say, 30 bar. Okay, 30 bar is here. We want to compress 20 bar. And what I'm saying is that the ideal process, the most ideal process, it follows, if you see here, these are the isentropic lines. These lines that go like that, these are isentropic. So that's the best you can do to go from that pressure to this pressure. This is the best trajectory you can make. So that will be two isentropic and one. And if you see, that gives you a significant increase in temperature. That gives you 160 degrees Celsius, okay? From 760, I think. How much? No, 70, okay? From 70 to 160. In reality, we don't have that process, but we have another process that goes and the temperature gives even higher. And that's what we call the polytropic process. Let me put it with another color. Well, that's what we call polytropic. Okay? And you have, so then you have this H, delta H, is the isentropic. And this delta H is actually this delta H polytropic. That is the real, work that I have to make to compress the fluid from 1 to 30 bar. Okay? And we have all the equations here. So we have the real temperature increase is given by that, and N is a function of polytropic efficiency that we will see just now what it is. But see that equation, and that equation resembles somehow, so this temperature, let me put it on that side, okay? Temperature times that, that's exactly equal to T2 minus T1, right? And if you remember in liquids, we, and that will be somehow similar to Cp T2 minus T1, right? Okay, and that's H2 minus H1. It's similar, not exactly the same, but that's what I'm trying to do here with this expression. Okay? Delta H due to polytropic, and then I have a bunch of things that represent somehow this Cp. It's not the same because that approximation is just for liquids. Okay? But it resembles that. Okay, so the next thing that we need to know is that usually we define delta H polytropic divided by the gravitational acceleration. That's what we call HP, and that's what we call the polytropic head. Okay, just like in the same way that we have done for pumps, it's a polytropic head. And that head, for particular P1 inlet pressure, T1 inlet temperature, molecular weight, and K, it looks something like that. It looks like, as you will suspect, what every machine every looks like, every rotating machine, like a available pressure curve. Okay? If I have lower rate, I can deliver more the head, and if I have more rate, I can deliver less head. Okay, and then I have for different rotational speeds N1, N2, N3. Okay? The thing is that we have, in reality, these conditions probably will change, okay? The temperature, the inlet pressure, the molecular weight, and the K, not so much, but they will change. So what the manufacturer does, they test the compressor at P inlet, P1 equal to atmospheric, and T1 equal to also standard conditions, 15.56. Okay, and with air, so molecular weight is 28.97, and with the K of the air, that is 1.3, I think. Well, you check, but 1.3, that's what I think. And then make a map that maps the polytropic head versus the Q actual. But then what happens when I want to use it at this particular pressure, temperature, molecular weight, and K with another fluid, with another pressure and temperature conditions? So I have to make a correction to calculate compressor performance. For other conditions, different than the test, then I have to apply the following corrections. In the rate, I say Q actual will be Q of the test and K actual over K of the test times molecular weight of the test over molecular weight actual that I have, and temperature of the conditions that I want and the temperature of the test. So that's how I convert that point that I have here. I convert it to a point in the real under my real conditions. Okay. And also I can do the same thing with the polytropic head. Polytropic head that I will have, the corrected, will be M molecular weight that I have over molecular weight, sorry, the molecular weight of the test times T one that I have over T1 test times K that I have over K test times HP of the test. Okay, so that's how I pass certain pair that I have here of Q and H. That's how I convert it to the actual conditions that I have. Now I give you the same thing that was the same problem with the viscosity. Okay, with the viscosity, that pressure probably will change the suction pressure to the compressor. Okay. So I will have a different map for every year. Okay. It's like the same thing when the water cut is changing. If the water cut is changing, the viscosity is changing. And if the viscosity is changing, the map will look different every year. So what I recommend in this exercise is to plot the operational point not on the actual map, but on the test map. Okay? So I will suggest using that to find, to port the combination of Q and delta H that I'm going to get to convert it to the test map. And in that case, I will have, that map will remain all the time the same. Okay? But I will see if it falls inside or not of the map. Okay, that will come clear when we do the exercise. Okay, so before we go to the exercise, just to summarize our compressor constraints. Okay, just like what we have done for the pumps. Usually the discharge temperature has to be less or equal than 150 degrees Celsius. And that's because of several reasons. One of them is for the integrity of the pipeline, of the flow line, of the downstream flow lines. Okay. Then another reason is because of the avoid vaporization of the glycol, of the hydride inhibitor. And then another reason is to avoid damaging the seals of the compressor. So to avoid damaging the compressor seals. Okay. So you see, temperature is a very, very strong constraint. Then we have Then we have a power. Okay, you have to be less than the max power. And in that case, we're going to assume our maximum power, I think it's 11 megawatts. Okay, because that's the maximum machine size that has been, it's available from one subsea. Other constraints that I have, if the pressure at the suction, in that case I don't have any problem with cavitation, but what I have is I have the pressure at the suction has to be greater than 10 bar, okay, and that's just because of the seals, to activate the seals. Then the operational speed, okay, that in that case we want to keep it, so let's open the example. Just like in the case of the ESP, okay, but we have now a different way to calculate power, to calculate temperature, but it's exactly the same thing. So the goes from 9350 to 6800 RPM. RPM. Okay, has to be between that range. And the last thing we need is again the same. We have also the same phenomena of Q max and Q min. We have to be in between those ranges. Okay, Q has to be greater than a minimum and lower than a maximum. And usually that in the envelope that is depicted by a line. Okay, you have a line here and you will have a line there. And if you go, it's for a different reason. It's not because of the floating impeller for too much wear. But it's because if you are at a very high rate, you will have here problems that you will reach the sonic velocity some places in the machine. Okay, you will reach Mach equal than 1. And then if you remember, you cannot, if you have sonic velocity, you cannot increase the rate more than that. Okay, so in that case, you have what we call a sonic. So let's put it, maybe just put it here. That's due to sonic velocity in machine passages. And I want to avoid that, okay, that will achieve Mach equal 1. That there is a certain number that is called Mach that is equal very close to 1. And then Q min, that's because to avoid surge. Okay, that's another phenomena. When the rate is too low, then you start having instabilities that the rate goes in and out, okay, goes back and forth, okay, inside the machine. I'm trying to simplify, but I think you have seen that before. You have covered that before. So that's flow back and forth in the machine. We say it's unstable. Okay. So we have all of those constraints that we have to fulfill with our operation. And another assumption that we are going to make for our exercise is that the polytropic efficiency is going to be constant and it's going to be similar to 0.7 because it's a centrifugal machine. If you go for an actual machine, the efficiencies can be higher. But in that case, we're going to assume that it's constant and that it's 0.7. In reality, the efficiency is a function, is a very strong function of the rate. Okay? So you have, just like in the pump, you have a behavior that you have a rate where you have a maximum efficiency and then it starts to decline. Okay, but we're going to neglect that for now because it's already getting heavy to many things. So we have our snow white example. Okay, and we have done our calculations all the way until the end of the plateau, natural plateau. Now from this point, we want to start having, we are going to install the compressor in place, and we want to bridge the difference between the required and the available. Okay? So how do we calculate that? First, let's calculate this combination of delta P and rate that we want from the compressor. Okay? But if you remember, in the Snow White case, we had, okay, our wells, then we had a choke, then we had the template, and then we are here we had this pipeline PLEM, okay, pipeline entry module, and then we have the separator on shore. That's in Melcoya. Okay. And those are all the wells that we have in the cluster. Okay, so we were making calculations of the pressure required here, right? And the pressure available here at the wellhead, right? But now we are going to install the compressor exactly in the PLEM. Okay, we are going to, in the after I join, because that will save me money, okay, to avoid having, I think there are three wells, okay, in each template. Because then I can have just one station for all the field, right? If I put it here, then I will have to put two stations for each template. Okay, so I'm going to put it here so it will allow to boost the production from all wells. Okay, but if you remember now, this is my point of interest. So I have to calculate my pressure required downstream, okay, and my pressure available upstream. So I have to change the equilibrium point. That's something that is very important. Now the equilibrium point cannot be anymore at the wellhead, but I have to change it and move it to the PLEM. Okay? So let's do that. Okay, so the rate I'm going to assume I want to produce exactly that. Okay, 20 million. GP will be calculated exactly in the same manner. Okay. Set also again. I think I have to pull everything down. Okay, P wellhead. All of that can remain the same. Here I'm making from reservoir to bottom hole, from bottom hole to wellhead. Okay, but now I have to continue. I have to go to the wellhead, I have to go to the PLEM, right? So let's see here. So let's, just to make sure we're not making any mistake. So that will be wellhead, P wellhead. Then I had here one pressure that was P template, that is that pressure, that I said really that distance is very, very short, so I can assume that it's the same for every well, right? Okay, so now we are going to say the choke is fully open after I reach the end of the plateau, so I'm just going to say P template is just going to be equal to wellhead, okay, right? And then I have to move with the flow line all the way to the PLEM. So let's do that. KP template, and in that case won't be any more required, but it will be available, and that will be exactly the same as the wellhead pressure. So I'm going to put here a slash saying that it's also available. And then I move forward to the PLEM. Again, for the PLEM, I need line P2. Okay, and the constant of the flow line is this one from the template to the PLEM, and I have to block it. And P1 will be the pressure at the template, and the rate will be the rate of the template. Okay. That I think I have it here, so I'm just going to take that, even though it's empty. I have to drag that. And, okay, and the separator pressure will be 30. So far I have done my calculations all the way up to here, and I have to make my calculations countercurrent from Hammerfest, from Melkoya, all the way to the discharge of the compressor. Okay, but for that I'm going to create here another column called PPLEM required. OK, Okay, and that will be line P.
One.
P one. Okay. And the flow line. That one will be the pipeline, right? P two will be the separator pressure. And Q will be the rate of the whole field. Hmm? So it will be this one.
And the fixed maybe the coefficient.
Hmm?
Fixing the coefficient.
Okay, the coefficient, very otherwise we have issues. 78. So the compressor has to give a delta P of this one minus this one. Okay? So initially 1.94 bar. Hmm? The temperature at the suction, I think the temperature of the reservoir is 92, and I think it's 67, if I'm not mistaken. But we just assume that's an input. And the pressure ratio will be the pressure at the discharge, that will be this number divided by the pressure at the suction. 1.03. Yes, so far so good. Yeah. So we also need to calculate, remember to calculate, now we have to know if the point falls inside the map, okay? So we have to find the temperature. With the temperature, we find the enthalpy difference, and with the enthalpy difference, we find the polytropic head. Okay, and then we convert from actual conditions to test conditions. Yeah? You see the logic? The steps? So let's see here. We need to estimate a T outlet. And that we do with the expression T2 over T1 RP N minus 1 over N. Okay? Then after we have that, we can calculate, estimate delta HP, and that will be with that equation that we have up here, this equation. Okay, and after I have that, I can calculate the polytropic head. HP, okay, that will be just delta HP over G, and now we have the Y component, okay, in the plot. We have this component, but the other thing we need is the actual flow rate. Again, we have is the standard conditions rate, so we have to convert between local and standard. And how do we do that? Okay, BG, what is the equation? BG, that is a function of pressure and temperature, right? Q at standard conditions. Is it correct? BG is local divided by a standard condition, right? So we need to have that expression, and you remember that BG is, what is the equation of BG? ZRT over T standard conditions, and you have a P someplace that is P standard conditions over P, right? I think so. Okay, and after I have HP and the Q actual, then I have to convert it to test conditions. To plot in the compressor map, okay, and see if it falls in the map. Okay, so that's the whole process we are going to make. But before that, let's just drag. I think we can just drag this down, right, to see how the pressure ratio will go with time. Hmm? So let's drag this down. Okay, we're keeping the same rate constant from the field, but now if you see with time, now the delta P of the compressor should increase from 2 bar to the next year will be 11 bar, then will be 21, 32, 46, 74. And then what happens is that you need actually a negative wellhead pressure to keep that rate from the well. Okay, so really we are going now to neglect for now, for time being, these 2 years. Yep. Okay, so next step, the polytropic efficiency, I told you we're going to assume 0.7. Okay, just to make our life simple. NP, I have a formula to convert for you. The here, N with polytropic efficiency, and K. Okay, K here, it's calculated for the gas as a function of its specific gravity. Okay, it's already calculated for you. So let's put here N exponent. And this N exponent is using K, that will be frozen. And we'll use this polytropic efficiency, 1.4. Now the temperature at the discharge, I think I have a formula also for you someplace, or maybe not. So the temperature will be, temperature at the inlet, right, at the suction, but has to be in, remember everything has to be in absolute units, times the pressure ratio that I calculated here to the power of n minus 1 over n. Right? Pressure ratio, temperature? Oh, that should be 0.15, right? So absolute temperature at the inlet times the pressure ratio to the power of n minus 1 over n, the polytropic exponent. And that we will obtain in Kelvin, right? So we have to subtract to get it in Celsius, we have to subtract 273.15. 69, that doesn't make, okay, yeah, maybe the pressure ratio is too small. Okay, and then I go up, and if you see here, we already see that we have kind of a problem. We go higher than 150. Okay, so probably in one of these years, we have to reduce the rate. Okay. Set deviation factor, we needed to calculate C average. Okay, we need the deviation factor for inlet and outlet. So for that we use our calculator, CFACT standing. Wait, not here, but here. The pressure, and the pressure can be in bar, and that has to be the inlet pressure. And the inlet pressure is this one, is it? Right? Then the temperature will be the temperature of the suction, is this temperature. Then the specific gravity of the gas, it's here. And I have to block it. And then the unit is 2 for metric. Okay? And then I do here... something similar. But this one will take the pressure from the discharge, that it will be this one, okay? The temperature of the discharge, that will be the temperature that I just calculate, the specific gravity of the gas that is up here, and the unit will be 2 again, Okay, and 0.93. Nothing much, not much change in this set. Okay, now I want to calculate the local rate at the inlet of the compressor. So for that I need the BG at the suction. So I think I have that one, I think I have a formula for you. Or maybe not. It's not here, flow equations. Yeah, BG. And it's pressure at standard conditions times set at local conditions times temperature at local conditions divided by temperature at standard conditions times P at local conditions. I think that's the equation we have in let's see, that's the equation we have here. So that's another complication that we didn't use in the Peregrino example, okay, that we assume that the local rate equal to the standard rate. But actually you have to convert for gases, particularly important. So you have set, you have pressure at standard conditions, you have R shouldn't be here, okay, so we have to, because it goes away with the R below, and pressure and temperature. Okay, so let's use that formula, it's called BG. And BG is taking the temperature in Celsius, right? At the suction, this one. The pressure at the suction, that is this one. And the set.
Should be in the Kelvin.
Hmm?
Temperature in the Kelvin.
Yeah, we check. I will check it now. And at the suction, 0.01 should be a very small value. And let's check the temperature is in Celsius. Okay, because here I'm summing up 273. Okay, and that gives more or less in the order of magnitude. BG is 1 minus 2, 1 to the minus 3. So I drag it down. And then I can calculate how was the equation, the Q of the field at standard conditions times the BG, right? Okay, so I have the Q, and now to plot it in the envelope, okay, if you see the plot, I need also the polytropic head. Okay, so I need to make that calculation. Where is the equation? That equation here, and I think that equation we have it programmed someplace. So let me see. Compressor. HP, polytropic head. Okay, here I have, yeah, that looks exactly like what I need, right? The polytropic head. So let's see here, polytropic head, and that's actually, so what is giving me is the head, okay? So I have to multiply times the gravitational acceleration to get the delta P, the enthalpy difference, okay? If you remember from that equation here, we have, the equation is giving us this number, and we want to calculate that number. So, HP, and that is asking for a pressure ratio. Temperature, that's the temperature at the inlet, okay? So suction temperature. The set, which is the average between that number and that number, okay, divided by 2. N is a polytropic exponent, and R is the not the universal, but the gas constant, okay? And if you remember, it was the universal divided by the molecular weight. And here I'm not sure about the units, 8314, over over the molecular weight, and the molecular weight is here, and I block it. But I'm really not sure about the units. So that should be times 9.81, right? Because that's the polytropic head, and we want to get. But I'm not really sure about the units. So should we check it? That R is in. What is the units of the universal gas constant? Is it 8314 joule over kilomole Kelvin? Is
yeah,
it? 100% sure? Yeah?
Yeah.
Okay. So then it's okay because that is in. Then you multiply times. You divide by the molecular weight, which is kilogram over kilomole, and that gives you joule over kilogram Kelvin. Right? And then you have a delta T, which takes away the Kelvin. And that gives you joule over kilogram. Hmm? Yeah? Okay, so I trust you. Okay, then mass flow. How do we calculate the mass flow?
Flow rate over density.
We have just 4 minutes to go, so. Mass flow, it's we could use it with the local flow rate and the density, but then we need to calculate the density. But we can also say the standard rate and the density at standard conditions, right? So that one I have calculated also for you here up. So the density at standard conditions, just using again the same equation of state, is 0.67. So the mass flow will be 0.67. The rate at standard conditions times the density at standard conditions. Okay, I'm going to block that. And then that is in days, and I want it in to make it consistent, so it will give me in watts, that should be in per second. So in day by second, I have to divide by 24 times 360. That's a huge rate. And then the power, let's see if we have an equation for power. Yeah, not really. Yeah, with power, we know that the power is the mass flow, okay, times this delta enthalpy divided by
product of efficiencies.
The efficiency, polytropic efficiency, times the mechanical efficiency that we are going to assume 95, for example. And this is in megawatts, so I should divide by 1e6, right? Okay, 1.2, 2.6, 4.6, and 8. So you know already in this year we have a problem. First, the outlet temperature is too high, and then the power that I need is also too high. I should be, I think the limit we set is 5 or 5.5 for our exercise. It's 11, but I think this year this is two boosters. Or one. I'm not sure. We have to. Yeah, no, I think it's one booster. So we should be fine here, but not fine this year. Okay? Okay, finally, what do we need now? We have calculated, let's go to our checklist. We have calculated temperature, check, Polytropic difference check, polytropic head check, Q actual check, and now I have to convert from actual conditions to test conditions to plot them on the same map. Okay, so for that we have again another, you know, I save some time for you. So Q test, and then you give all of that information that will give you the Q test of the rate in test conditions. So let's first use that. H, I think the name was H equivalent, right? HP test. Okay, actual, and that will be that number, but divided by, right, by 9.81. To give me the polytropic head. Then the temperature of the actual is the temperature at the suction, and that temperature is that number, and I think it has to be in absolute units. Then a temperature of the test, I should have it here someplace. Test conditions here, test, block it. K actual, it's this one, block it. K test is this one, block it. Molecular weight of the test is 1, so it's the molecular weight of the air. Okay, the molecular weight of the air is how much? 0.97. And the molecular weight of the actual test is 16. Okay. Right, 43. I think it looks fine. So let's check about H temperature. Looks fine. Okay, so let's check just the expression to see if just the ratio. Yeah, so the temperature should be in an absolute in Kelvin, in absolute units. And then the Q actual is Q test, and that will be Q actual. This number, temperature actual, suction temperature, that is someplace here on the left, plus 273.15. Just going to finish, T test, it's that temperature, frozen, QA, this K, frozen, K test, this one frozen, and molecular weight of the test, 28.97. And the molecular weight is 16, right? That is what's up here. Okay, and now we see how the points plot in this diagram. Okay, with time, so we just say select data, add, and we have, even the computer says stop, stop. No more information. Okay, Q on the x-axis, and on the y-axis, HP. And I think we have a, because we are getting how much? 6,000, and here we are getting 1,000, 2,000, 9,000. Okay? And the rate 2,280 something, and here we're getting, so the rate looks okay, and the head looks like so maybe it's just the last point that is too high. So let me just freeze that here. It's already frozen, so why? Well, let's I will upload it. We continue on Thursday, but you, so far is, you know, it takes significantly much more effort than the pump case, okay? Just we have to calculate all of these, to calculate the power and to calculate the head, we need all of these intermediate steps. But we will see, I will also do some debugging, but I think it's okay. We just have to plot the points and see if they fall inside the envelope or not. And then what can we do to put the points inside the envelope? That will be how we start next Thursday. Okay? Any question before we close? Okay. See you on Thursday.